Welcome to The Rich Report, a podcast with news and information on the world of big data. Today, my guest is from TenGen. We have the Director of Product Strategy, Nosh Petigara. So, Nosh, welcome to the show today.
Thanks, Rich.
I'm glad you could join us today, Nosh. You know, I brought your slides up. Why don't we start with that, and we'll follow it with a Q&A.
That sounds great. I'm going to talk today about TenGen, the company, about MongoDB, which is the open source non-relational database that TenGen develops, and then going to talk about some of the use cases and technology behind that, and then finally some of the partnerships and the recent announcement around what we're doing with Red Hat. So to start out with, just a little bit of company background and history. TenGen is about 4 years old. We're a venture-backed company based in New York with offices in California, Dublin, and London. And we develop MongoDB. MongoDB is an open-source non-relational database. We have about 100 employees around the world working on MongoDB, its drivers, and its ecosystem around that. And to introduce MongoDB, it's often helpful for people who aren't familiar with NoSQL and what non-relational databases are to give sort of a highlight of what's happening in the database market right now. So if you take a look at the emerging database landscape, there are a couple of interesting things happening there. Starting in around the 1980s, if you were a software developer and you wanted to store your data somewhere, the only place that you could do it was either in a relational database like Oracle or in a flat file on your file system. But then starting in the 1990s and through the 2000s, the database market fragmented, and you had these two major categories emerge. The first was, of course, the relational database, which has been around for a long time, and the second category was the data warehouse, and names like Teradata and things like that were products and companies that came out to address this type of market. And what developers ended up doing was storing all their sort of online data or OLTP type data and applications in a relational database, while if they needed to do analysis or data warehousing, those went into specialized databases for those purposes. And this has sort of been the status quo for some time now. Though recently a third category has emerged, and that is the category of NoSQL or non-relational databases. And what we're seeing is a large portion of web and enterprise applications that used to be architected on relational databases are moving towards NoSQL databases like MongoDB. And additionally, what we're seeing is where data analysis needs need to be performed, and they can't wait for the traditional ETL, batch load, and then long query time type infrastructure. Those are moving as well to non-relational databases. So, you know, moving along, you know, there are three main reasons why this shift is happening, and these are pretty obvious to sort of most people, but they've come together in an interesting way. The first is, as everybody knows, big data is upon us. Companies are collecting and have more and more data at their disposal, and they're interested in ensuring that they can actually take advantage of that data. And so databases need to be able to handle a higher volume of data at a higher velocity and deal really well with both structured and unstructured or semi-structured data. And the second interesting thing that's happening is that the mantra these days is agile development. So companies want to be able to iterate very, very quickly on their applications. And a traditional relational database is not the best tool for doing that. You're stuck in a rigid schema. You need to predefine that schema, and it's often hard to change after the fact. So a database like MongoDB, it handles a large volumes of data. It's schema-free, so you can just start putting your data into MongoDB and evolve your schema over time. And then finally, the third trend that's come together with the first two is the shift to cloud-like or virtualized infrastructure. You know, when you're deploying an application today, you don't want to be tied to an expensive hardware platform. Companies are looking to deploy in either public clouds or building out private clouds or virtualized infrastructure in their own data centers, and relational databases aren't the best tool for deploying in that type of environment. Traditionally, what you've had to do is scale vertically or scale up to scale your relational database, so essentially get a lot of CPUs and a lot of memory into one machine, and host your database there. While the mantra with cloud computing is really to take smaller commodity type machines and build your applications on top of many of those, and non-relational databases like Mongo allow you to do that. So the key to understanding MongoDB is really understanding the document structure. MongoDB is what's called a document database. And instead of storing your data in tables and rows and columns, you store it in documents. To a web developer, these documents will be really familiar. MongoDB uses a version of JSON, which is JavaScript Object Notation. And what that allows you to do is take a whole lot of data and pack it into one data structure and store that in your database. And what I have up here on the slide is a representation of what a blog post might look like as a document. So you can see a few things with this document. The first is that it's got an ID. This is the primary key for the document. But then it's got a whole bunch of other fields. So for example, there's a title, and there's a date, and there's the actual text for that blog post, and these are simple fields. But additionally to those simple fields, you have more complex data structures that you can embed in those documents. So for example, I have a votes field, and that actually contains an embedded document which has upvotes and downvotes, and it's got an array of tags. And then finally, for comments, it has an array of embedded documents. And what this allows you to do is really take a data modeling problem that in a relational database would have been split out into maybe 10 or 12 different tables and compress that down into one single document. And this has a couple of great advantages. One, it's easier to understand and represent. So for example, blog posts need to be, blog posts are single units, so storing them in a single unit makes sense rather than trying to split them up among various different tables. And secondly, what it allows you to do is do really high performance queries without having to join data. So for example, to retrieve all the blog posts by a particular author or the last 10 blog posts or blog posts that match a particular tag, you don't need to essentially reassemble by joining this data from multiple tables. You can go directly do lookups. So MongoDB, the core notion for data in MongoDB are these documents. These documents can be stored on a single server or a replicated cluster, but in addition to doing that, what you can actually do is tell MongoDB, hey, break up my collection of blog posts here by a particular field. So let's say I break it up by the title. What MongoDB will then do is take a portion of those blog posts, say from starting with A to K, and assign them to a certain machine in the cluster, and then take the next range and assign them to another cluster. And it can do this dynamically, so as you need more capacity, both in terms of data storage or in terms of throughput for reads and writes, you can dynamically add new machines to the cluster. MongoDB understands that and will rebalance the cluster so all the documents are distributed evenly across your database and across these large clusters. So typically what we see is for small applications, a user might have a cluster of two or three machines, but that can grow very large to hundreds of machines for storing terabytes and terabytes of data, or if they have really high throughput needs. And it turns out that this document structure is really useful for a number of different use cases, and up on the next slide, I've highlighted a few of them along with some of the companies who are using them. And we saw the blog post example there, and just carrying on from that, content management is one area where the document structure is really useful. It's a great fit for storing everything from web content to metadata to things like that. We're seeing a lot of interest in using MongoDB for e-commerce, and things like product catalogs are great fits for this document structure. And then, there are emerging areas such as online gaming, where user profiles and game actions really fit very well into this document model and are much better represented as a document than as relations in a table. We're also seeing some very interesting use cases around real-time analytics or operational analytics. So, for example, if you're interested in tracking in real time where visitors are on your website, You don't want to take a log file, ETL it, upload it into a data warehouse, and run queries on it. You want to be able to have that data available in real time. So, for example, if you're a media company and you want to adjust which stories are showing up on your homepage and in which order, you need to be able to do those real-time analytics and counters exceptionally quickly. And MongoDB allows you to do that and can scale to a massive number of page views, for example, and do those computations in real time in the database. Moving along, I thought I'd mention about the MongoDB community. As I mentioned, MongoDB is open source and has a great community of developers supporting MongoDB. A large portion of what we do as an organization is get the word out about MongoDB to various development communities across the world. We do this through a few different activities. The major ones are what we call MongoDB Days, and these are one-day conferences packed with technical content that we do every few weeks in cities around the world. We have two big ones coming up, one in San Francisco and one in New York. And we had about over 1,000 people last year at Mongo Silicon Valley. And then we have a number of them, whether they're in Europe or Asia or other cities in the U.S. that are smaller. We have very active MongoDB user groups, and these get together about once a month and talk about topics and applications and techniques to use with MongoDB as well. And then, of course, like many open source projects, we have very active forums and our IRC channels and things like that where users can come and contribute and help test and write code for MongoDB. If you're following the MongoDB and NoSQL space, it's interesting to take a look at how the various players are doing in this space. On the next slide, I have a couple of charts up there, and these are things that we use to gauge how our interest is relative to other companies in the space. The one on the left there shows the web search interest in MongoDB, and the red line that's trending in 2003 and into 2012 shows a sort of progression of MongoDB, and this is the volume of searches that have included the term MongoDB on Google. So definitely within the NoSQL space, we're definitely leading the pack there. Another interesting statistic is tracking how many job postings mention the word MongoDB, and this helps us gives us insight into how the commercialization of the technology is going. And definitely we're seeing a lot of interest in using MongoDB in a variety of different areas. And interestingly, the second highest job trend for 2011 as tracked by Indeed was actually MongoDB, just under HTML5 and even bigger than iOS. Another key component is our alliances. We're building out a very strong ecosystem, and up on the next slide I've listed out a number of different companies we work with. As MongoDB is used for what I would consider the next generation of applications, we see a lot of interest in using MongoDB on various cloud platforms. We work closely with companies like Amazon and Rackspace and Joyent and Red Hat. And additionally, we have a number of different companies who we work with, from things like reporting tools from Jaspersoft and Pentaho, to interesting things on the hardware side, like working with Fusion.io to make sure that MongoDB performs well on their solid-state drives, and various other things like that. The last thing I wanted to talk about was just the recent announcement that we did with Red Hat. We've been working with Red Hat for over a year, and the first joint solution we did together was around OpenShift. OpenShift is Red Hat's platform as a service. You can use it today. Just go to openshift.com. You can get an account. You can very easily upload an application, and with the click of a button or with a single command line, you can actually boot up a MongoDB database, so any application that's written on OpenShift can take advantage of MongoDB and use it. And since that has gone tremendously well, We've deepened our partnership with Red Hat to extend not just to OpenShift but across their product lines. So we're working in a very solution-oriented approach to them to help integrate MongoDB along with a lot of their different product lines. And the first project we're coming out with jointly is a blueprint for running MongoDB on Red Hat Enterprise Linux. This will be a sort of quick start guide or a reference architecture that will allow a developer or an administrator to take MongoDB and run it in a high-performance Red Hat environment. And this is really what customers are asking for because, you know, they've heard about big data, they've heard about the cloud, that they're dipping their toes in, and now they want solutions that help them, you know, deploy them reliably, securely, and with high performance. So we're going to be working very closely with Red Hat over the coming months. We've lined up a couple of interesting projects in integration. We're going to be working with the JBoss teams, the CloudForms teams, and the Gluster teams. And really what we're doing is allowing companies to take their existing infrastructure and integrate MongoDB into them and know that they have a strong open source foundation behind them with Red Hat and Tengen. So that's all I have for today. Any questions, Rich?
Yeah, certainly. Thanks for that, Nosh. Well, let's start with the most recent thing first, the Red Hat announcement. So you guys make your money by doing support, right? Making the MongoDB, the enterprise ready and supporting that. How will this work with Red Hat? Will they provide first call support or will you?
So at this point, it's going to be a joint sales effort. So Tengen makes its money by selling subscriptions. We sell server subscriptions quite similar to Red Hat does today or how MySQL did prior to their acquisition, and we sell a similar offering. You can download MongoDB and use it for free, or you can purchase subscriptions from Red Hat and from Tengen, and you get support for those. So we'll be working jointly with Red Hat, so you know, at this point we'll be doing that individually. Over time, that may change as we get more integrated.
And I was interested in that last mention of the Mongo DB with Gluster, which Red Hat bought. I think they're calling it Red Hat Storage System or something. But will that effort, that collaboration, will that be centered around performance or will it be about deployment like this most current thing?
Yeah, primarily around deployment. Where, you know, what we're looking to do is really make sure that MongoDB is compatible and works well with all of Red Hat software. Gluster, you know, is a very interesting distributed file system, and having that, being able to store either MongoDB data files on Gluster or actually storing metadata for certain, you know, binary data or unstructured data that resides on Gluster are two areas that we're looking at to collaborate with them over time.
Great. And then, you know, Nosh, I was really impressed by the wide breadth of people that are using MongoDB on the one slide you had there. What do you think the appeal is? Is it just that it's open source and that it's the way it structures data with these documents, or is it more to it than that?
I think there are really three reasons. I think the primary reason is ease of use. It really is much easier to develop a lot of different applications against a document model rather than being constrained in a relational model, and that really draws developers in. The fact that it's open source makes it accessible and a really frictionless process to get up and running. You know, our focus is really helping people get using MongoDB. So, for example, you can just go to our website. You don't need to register. You can just download it. If you have problems, write into our forums. And sort of that combination of a great community help, you know, it being open source and being really a much easier tool to use draws developers in. The second aspect of it, as you need to scale, MongoDB gives you that ability. So even if your application is small today, but you think you're going to need to scale in the future, MongoDB gives you a path to do that. And that path is one that can be taken incrementally because you can add these commodity machines to your cluster and scale as your business does. And lastly, it's really, you know, as companies try and move, you know, more of their infrastructure to cloud-like environments, they really need a data store that works well and is designed for that type of environment. And you know, MongoDB being a more modern technology has really been designed for that type of virtualized or commodity hardware environment.
Well, great. Well, Nosh, kind of a wrap-up question here. I mean, how do people that are interested and our listeners out there, how do they engage with Mongo? Do you work primarily through channels like or partners like Red Hat? How does it work for your community?
There are a couple of different ways. You know, one is a more community-oriented approach, and one's a more commercial relationship, and people can choose either. So if you're a developer and you're interested in trying out the technology, go to mongodb.org. That's where all the documentation for MongoDB is. That's where you can download MongoDB and all of the language drivers. And you'll see links there for our community forums, for our bug tracking database, for IRC channels and things like that, and as well as information about things like meetups. And if you're a company looking to try out MongoDB and you're looking for services around the database or for someone to come in and really help you understand how MongoDB can help your business, head over to tengen.com and you'll see the various services we provide and there are ways to contact us directly through that.
Well, terrific. Well, Nosh, I want to thank you once again for coming on the show today.
Great. Thank you so much. Really appreciate the opportunity.
You bet. Okay, folks, that's it for the Rich Report. Stay tuned for more news and information on the world of big data.